For every anime fan out there, there always seems to be that one series that gets them into the medium like none other. Sure, they might have seen other popular anime beforehand, like, say, Dragon Ball Z, Sailor Moon, or Pokemon, but for those who stuck around, there was always something that acted as the tipping point, the somewhat more buried title that encouraged them to go the extra mile and seek what else the field had to offer. For me, that was a little series called Detective Conan. The first time I ever saw Detective Conan was English dubbed on a little-known channel called Colors TV on satellite. The English dub by Funimation was pretty well done, though a lot of the content, such as cultural references or character names, were heavily westernized. On TV, I knew it as Case Closed, as that was the English dub title chosen by the Western marketing team due to legal considerations. I remember the episode I first saw with extreme clarity. The show, when I started watching, seemed to focus this time on a group of children with an older girl and her father on a bullet train. Things were fairly routine until the main child noticed some suspicious activity revolving around some men in black coats who he apparently identified as men who had shrunken him from an adult size to a kid's size. Although I didn't really know the plot around the character, it was interesting enough and easy enough for me to piece together from the surrounding context clues. What was even more interesting, though, was that there was a bomb on the train. And within a limited amount of time, the main kid had to figure out where the train had a bomb on it, and had to use his deductive reasoning and skill to do so. Eventually, of course, our main character, Conan, found the bomb and kicked it out the window just in time to save the day. It was an incredibly compelling roller coaster ride, one part mystery, one part thriller, and I needed to see more of it. Detective Conan was initially conceived in 1994 during the rise of the mystery genre manga, specifically thanks to the publishing of the series The Kindaichi Case Files. The first chapter appeared in Weekly Shonen Sunday on January 19th of that year. The author, one Gosho Aoyama, cites the stories of Arsène Lupin, samurai films by Akira Kurosawa, and Sherlock Holmes in particular as influences on his work. There are innumerable references to Doyle's work littered throughout the series, in fact. I mean, where do you think he got the name Conan from, huh? The animated television adaptation is produced by TMS Entertainment, and over 900 episodes have aired in Japan since the anime's premiere on January 8, 1996, making it the 16th longest anime series to date. As of 2019, 22 feature films based around the series have been released, all animated by TMS. The films have been released in April of each year, starting in 1997 with the first film, The Time-Bombed Skyscraper. The 22nd film, Zero the Enforcer, was released on April 13, 2018. There have been countless other Conan media over the years as well, ranging from OVAs to television specials, a crossover with Lupin the Third, live-action dramas, and plenty of video games. Detective Conan has sold over 200 million volumes worldwide, making it the fourth best-selling manga series of all time, having been sold in 25 different countries. In Japan, individual volumes regularly appear with frequency on the lists of best-selling manga. The animated adaptation as well appeared in the top 6 of Japanese television rankings at various times, ranking among the top 20 in polls conducted by Animage magazine from 1996 to 2001. Aoyama and his creations are celebrated in his hometown of Hokue, Tottori, which houses a museum with exhibits of his work and several bronze statues of Shinichi Kudo, Konan Edogawa, and Ran Mori. It also has various other tourist attractions related to the series, such as a themed airport and train station, and it is promoted as Conan Town. Licensed merchandise sales for the series alone added up to around $366 million between 2003 and 2012. So, what is it that draws people in about this little detective so much? What makes this series so memorable despite its absurd length? And what about its appeal has kept people coming back for around 25 years now with no clear sign of stopping yet? Well, everyone, that's exactly what we're here to discuss today. So, fasten your voice-changing bow ties, tie the shoestrings on your power sneakers, and let's talk about why you should watch / read Detective Conan. So for those of you needing a brief explanation of what the plot of Detective Conan even centers around, let's start off with a basic little recap. Shinichi Kudo is a high school detective who works at times with the Japanese police to solve difficult cases. He's a total nerd who loves Sherlock Holmes and wants to be just like him when he grows up. Except this Holmes, not... this Holmes. One night, while on a date with his childhood sweetheart Ranmori at an amusement park called Tropical Land, a terrible murder happens and he has to solve it. Of course. Sorry about the trauma. Anyway, after solving the crime, Shinichi notices a sketchy meeting going down with some guy in black who is also looking kinda shady on the aforementioned roller coaster, despite not being the murderer in said case. He shimmies his jimmies over to the scene and sees an illegal deal going down between some business guy and the man in black, and tries to record it on his talkboy, determined to expose their crimes to the authorities, until of course another man in black comes up from behind him like,
"Are you sure about that?"
The other man in black whips out his cane and clocks Shinichi over the head, feeding him an experimental poison developed by his super-secret crime organization, which is supposed to super-secretly kill someone without leaving any trace of itself in their body, because it's super-secret. They leave and he dies. Okay, no, but seriously, he turns into a 6-year-old. Running home, he meets up with his old crazy scientist neighbor friend, Professor Agasa, and after a little bit of convincing, gets him to realize that he's Shinichi. Professor Agasa gets him to bum off Ran for a while under a false identity, Conan Edogawa, so they can potentially learn more about the organization that drugged him through her father, a private detective named Kogoro Mori, who kinda sucks at being smart. One of the key requirements of being a detective. Of course, out of interest in his loved one's safety, Shinichi can't tell anyone that he's been shrunk to a child's size, and so he must proceed to dig deeper into this mysterious organization, befriend various police detectives from different regions, go to first grade again, and solve so many murders in a short period of time that you'll wonder how everyone in Japan isn't just dead already. Okay, so yes, Conan has a bit of a cheesy plot, I'll admit that much. But the real charm of the series comes from its excellent episodic mysteries, which take up the vast majority of its various chapters and anime episodes. When scripting each chapter of the manga, Aoyama says he ensures that the dialogue remains palatably simple so that the overwhelming amount of it needed to explain each mystery is not confusing or difficult to follow. He spends an average of 4 hours plotting out each new case, and up to 12 hours for more complicated ones. Each case tends to span several chapters, and is resolved at the end where a character explains the details of their solutions. So yeah, a lot of these cases are self-contained murder mysteries, each with their own colorful cast of characters, circumstances, setting, and method of having carried out the murder. What's so special about that, you may ask, considering this genre of story is fairly common? Well, first of all, there's the amount of effort Aoyama pours into every aspect of his work. For one, the few hiatuses he's taken, barring that for his health last year, have all primarily focused on intensive research specifically for authenticity's sake. He has mountains of documents and books specifically set aside for subjects of research ranging from instruments, police departments, to architecture, and so on, all for the sake of faithful recreation and understanding of these subjects within the pages of his manga. The man even performs a majority of the practical tricks used for crimes carried out in his manga to see if they translate workably into the real world. And that is a lot of dedication. With this all in mind, you start to realize that Aoyama is a very passionate author who puts immense care into what he does, down to even the placement of his word balloons for easier reader accessibility, and an extra draft in the usual mangaka's art process of 3 stages, extending it to 4 for each chapter. Keep in mind, Detective Conan is a weekly series and has been running for 25 years. This man seems to be practically inexhaustible. He's a living, breathing mystery machine. With this taken into consideration, it's easy to tell that his mysteries, writing-wise, are fairly up to snuff. He's made hundreds of individual murder cases interesting and compelling, and that in and of itself is an achievement worth lauding. One of the greatest strengths of this series, however, which feeds heavily into its lasting appeal, is the likability of its extensive cast of characters. Shinichi, or Conan, or whatever you want to call him, is an extremely likable guy who has a strong sense of justice, but also isn't perfect, rather dense when it comes to romantic matters, and has a really grating tone deafness when it comes to his singing. Aran is optimistic, romantic, and a bit of a firecracker when she's mad, but she can also be rather naive and slow to the punch. Kogoro is a drunken doof who's much too self-confident, greedy, and lecherous, but what he lacks in role model qualities, he tends to make up for by remaining a steadfast and responsible figure when the going gets rough. And these are just three of the main characters, in a series where recurring side characters are a sea's width worth, all of whom have notable personality traits, strengths, and weaknesses that make them feel real. This, combined with the series' long-running nature, really makes you feel like these characters are an organic part of your daily life. People just like you, who you've been friends with for a long time. Even if Conan is still six.
How long have you been six, Conan?
A while.
This level of characterization doesn't just reside within the main side casts, however, as tons of the series' more incidental characters have very compelling stories, especially in its cavalcade of sympathetic murderers. The perfect example I want to use to illustrate my point here is a specific case from early on in the series, the Moonlight Sonata case, in terms of the underlying plot which pops up every now and then in the series. This case doesn't really play much of a role in spoiling any of that, but I would still highly recommend watching this case if you haven't before listening to me talk about it. It's episode 11. If you just search Detective Conan episode 11, you'll find it. But if you don't mind some minor spoilers for one particular case, then here we go. One day, Kogoro receives a strange cut-and-paste letter from a client named Keiji Aso, calling him to the Tsukikage Island. After arriving at the island with Conan and Ran, Kogoro is surprised to find that the person apparently requesting an investigation from him is a man who's been dead for over 12 years. He was a world-renowned pianist who suddenly and without warning murdered his entire family, set his house on fire, and played Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata as his house crumbled around him. Already, we have a very strong and mysterious setup, which prompts us to want to know more about what exactly is going on here. Despite thinking that the letter is a stupid prank, Kogoro decides to investigate anyway, because he's already been paid for the job, and finds that the island is actually currently holding an election for mayor. 2 years prior, a passerby heard the Moonlight Sonata playing from the community center and discovered the body of the current mayor slumped over the piano, which formerly belonged to Keiji. Although he died from what appeared to be cardiac arrest, the similarity of the death with that of Aso's caused the islanders to believe that the piano had been cursed. During the funeral for the previous mayor, the Moonlight Sonata is heard from the piano room, and they discover one of the candidates for mayor murdered there. A letter written with a code of sheet music is also discovered at the scene of the crime, indicating that the murders are only just beginning. The police interrogate everyone that was at the funeral the following day, but when the second movement of the Moonlight Sonata is heard from up the stairs, Conan rushes to the scene and discovers yet another one of the mayoral candidates has been murdered. Music notes left by the killer reveal that he's avenging Keiji Aso, and not too long after, a third victim is hanged in the storage room of the community center. Though there appears to be a coded message at his feet confessing to the crimes, it seems unlikely that he could have hanged himself with no chair present underneath him. Nearby, although not playing, the third movement of the Moonlight Sonata is found recorded on a tape cassette. At the last moment, Conan realizes there was a piece of sheet music left locked up tight in Keiji's safe, which, when he obtains and decodes it, reads, "To my son, Seiji." Aso had a son who had become ill when he was a child and had to be hospitalized, meaning that he was not killed in the incident that took the lives of his family. Conan deduces the killer to be the island's doctor, Narumi Asai, who was, in fact, the long-lost Seiji Aso in disguise. After graduating, he came to the island disguised as a female doctor, hoping to enact revenge on the men involved. It turns out Kawashima, Nishimoto, Kuroiwa, and Kameyama all used Aso's international concerts as a front for their international drug trade. And when Keiji refused to cooperate any longer, they became frightened of their secrets being exposed, and locked the family in their home, setting it ablaze, and all of this was recounted in the sheet music code left behind in his safe as his confession to his remaining son, Seiji. Seiji had no idea of the note, but didn't buy the story about his father's death and sought to find out the truth. When he told the former mayor Kameyama his true identity, the late mayor was terrified, confessing everything before having a fatal heart attack. After Conan's deduction, Seiji attempts to commit suicide by setting the building on fire. when Conan shows him Keiji's dying message in an attempt to convince him to escape the burning building, Seiji, though grateful for Conan's words, says his hands are already covered in blood, tossing him out the window and playing the piano as the building burns down around him, just as his father had done in his death. The coded message he plays in the middle of the flames translates out to, "Thank you, little detective." Not only is this episode a nigh-perfect reflection of the appeal of the show's typical episodic premise, a wonderful depiction of its more emotionally punchy and sympathetic villains, and a beautifully haunting example of how the series weaves levity together with grisly crime drama, but it's extremely well thought out, planned, and executed in a way that makes each moment, each new clue, each new testimony, all the more interesting and effective at getting the gears in your brain turning. This case even gets the rare Detective Conan honor of being called back to, which is something that doesn't happen often in this series. A whole 67 episodes later, when a woman has a contingency plan to kill herself with a lighter after her plan has been found out, we find out that her supply of gas has already been replaced beforehand with water. And when Hattori asks Conan if it would have been better to let her die, he remarks that a detective who corners someone with their deduction to the point that they would commit suicide is no better than a murderer. This causes him to reflect on Seiji, which suggests he still feels a lot of personal guilt over this one. And if that's not really impactful, I don't know what is. You know, this series can be surprisingly dark when it wants to be, huh? I mean, sure, I know it thrives on tons of murder plots, but aside from the level of violence, a lot of the show is fairly family-friendly. Again, tone is worked extremely well by Aoyama, who seems to be able to mix light comedy, casual banter, and horrifying drama almost absurdly well. This series really knows when to emphasize certain emotions, and it's no stranger to getting them extremely right. At times, it can legitimately be pretty frightening, too, with episodes like the Mountain Villa Bandage Man murder case and the Art Museum murder case freaking my child self out super badly, with the latter actually causing me to shut the TV off and run downstairs. Yeah, that happened. This, combined with its various locales and incidental characters, really tends to give each Conan case a palpable and unique sense of atmosphere, which, when put together with its trademark mysteries, becomes a grab bag of compelling crime drama. Barring the occasional black organization-centric plot thread as well, a lot of Conan is simply episodic filler, which doesn't contribute much to the overall story, but every episode is still a joy to watch because of how well constructed they are. Of course, there are some misses every now and then, as with every long-running show, but the level of consistently excellent quality episodes, like 900 episodes down the line, is staggering, to say the least. Because of its highly episodic nature too, I'd argue that despite its length, it's very easy to get into. Again, because of the rarity of its plot-centric focus and its character introductions, a lot of the basic knowledge is soaked up from the series' beginnings, and that premise carries it for the vast majority. It's not like other long-runners, which are difficult to drop in on because of their ever-continuous narrative structure. You could feasibly watch a handful of episodes from season 1 and skip to season 3 if you so desired. There's always a running thread of understanding and iconic familiarity with these characters that will make it easy enough to engage with, no matter the level of dedication you want to put into it. Of course, if you do want to engage fully with the work instead of just the plot-important bits, though, there's an ocean's worth of clever crime puzzles to follow along with, and a vast majority of the cases even have most of its evidence clearly on display during the investigation process, meaning that if you're observational, you can often come to your own conclusions about the solution of the crime before it's revealed. It's fun to try and figure this stuff out, even if it's not always possible, or if, like me, you're just dumb. There's always such a simple pleasure to watching someone's impeccably complicated plan be unraveled by Conan, who's able to explain it every step of the way. It makes you, like, really take a step back and go like, "Oh! Now I see." It's a cool feeling. The animation might seem a little dated by now, especially in the earlier episodes, but recent seasons don't look half bad by long-running anime standards, and the style is still every bit as charming and expressive now as it's always been. The music in particular is one of the most standout elements of note in Conan's animated adaptation as well, containing tons of atmospheric tracks, somber tracks, and insanely earwormy jazz tracks that have become some of the most easily recognizable soundtrack tunes of all time to me. Like, seriously, if it's a song from Conan, I can tell it's from Conan. And of course, do I even need to say the voice acting is great? The voice acting's great, there I said it. Minami Takeyama's performance as Conan in particular is so iconic that it's just a bit of a joy in and of itself to hear her in the role. Other industry veterans litter the cast of this show, and in particular, I love Megumi Hayashibara as Ai Hibara, though that could simply be because Hibara is like the best character ever. Detective Conan is what a long-running manga or anime should aspire to be. Alive because of the passion of its creator and the dedication to telling a good story the right way. Not for magazine popularity, not for more merchandise sales, but for the vitality of the craft. To continue breathing life into your creative vision and dedicating every bit of work and energy required to do it justice. It takes all the infectious enjoyability of the Holmes and Kogoro Akechi shorts that inspired it and delivers consistently within a serialized detective story that has gripped millions for close to 3 decades now. This project is one unmistakably crafted by passion, and it's evident even in the art of the manga. Take, for example, an early page of Bleach, which most would agree was in its heyday, in its early arcs. The art's poppy, expressive, vibrant, alive, stylistic. And then take a look at a page from close to the end of its run. So much more stale, lifeless, and phoned in. Almost like you can feel Kubo's exhaustion radiating from the page. You can feel his indifference, his desire to just be done already. Conan's early pages look fantastic as well, but have you noticed something about this art from even just a fairly recent chapter? After the 1000 digit, by the way. It still looks great, and it looks great, reads great, and is great because even after all this time, Aoyama cares about what he's making, wants desperately to make it, and has a need to share it with us, with the world. Conan Edogawa may not be as much of a household name as Sherlock Holmes, but I'd argue that the work he inhabits has innovated beyond its creative roots, and has created our generation's greatest detective. And whether Detective Conan ends in 2 years or 10, I'll be along for the ride, ready to find out what happens when this case is closed. And that, among many other reasons, is why you should watch or read Detective Conan. Hey everybody, thanks for watching this video. I've wanted to do another video like this for a while now, and I figured why not do one about Conan, because I love Conan a lot and I could talk about Conan forever, so I'm glad I got to make a video about it. If you stuck around to the end of all this rambling and nonsense and me saying words about anime, I thank you for watching my videos. Maybe consider subscribing or commenting or liking or whatever. Or you could dislike or unsubscribe. You could shoot me in the face. Okay, actually, don't do that. Also, if you enjoyed this video and want to continue supporting the creation of my videos in the future, I have a Patreon where you can donate some monies for some rewards and stuff that you can see if you go there. And I have a Tumblr if you want to see me say words sometimes, very occasionally, not that much. It's NezumiVA.tumblr.com. I also announce stuff about videos there sometimes too, so that's cool. I think that's about it. So thank you for watching so much again. I'm very tired and I need to sleep. Peace.